Good afternoon, and thank you very much, of course, for this kind invitation. Now I'm trying, okay. I would like to say that, you know, there is an old story between Italy and Russia. This is Professor Luria on the left, who is one of the founders of the International Neuropsychology, and there is a very nice interaction between Italy and Russia. For example, Professor Bisiak, Giuseppe Cossu, and Patrizia Bisiacchi, they are all honorary professors in neuropsychology. They spent here in Moscow a couple of years working on neuropsychology, and they are able to speak a very good Russian, but I'm not. I'm sorry for this. But what I will do today is trying to give you a definitions of decision making, because we are speaking of this, and I will like to illustrate you the neurobiological correlates of these very complex behavior in humans. Decision making refers to the process of forming preferences, selecting and executing actions, and evaluating outcomes, or simply a willing process resulting in a single choice between multiple options. The real story is that during our life we make a thousand of decisions, even in the same day, and these decisions are very different concerning what we eat, but also the therapies we are going to face for the disease. Now, how do we decide? And if I say, how do we decide as patients and also as doctors, so the both of us, there are two components that may come into play. The first problem is cognition. But you know, the brain is not a computer. There is also a second component which is very relevant when we take any kind of decision, even in the professional environment. And the second component is emotion. And sometimes emotion and cognition are in conflict. Now, for example, let's take this example of a map. If we want to go to the sea place, you can decide two different or even more trajectories. This is a very cognitive decision. But let's make a second example. For example, in this case, I think that nobody of you will decide to get inside the fire, but make the example to have one of your family member there. Of course, your decision would be also influenced by the emotional component. Now, the relevant story by looking at the neuroscience is that the anatomical correlates of emotion and cognition are very different, as cognition is represented in the cortical areas, while a number of subcortical structures play an important role in controlling emotion. So there is a neurobiological conflict between different neural networks. Now, coming to the problem of the eternal conflict between emotion and cognitions, well, this becomes a real important problem if we take in consideration decision making in relevant situations, for example, in deciding a clinical pharmacological treatments, and also if we consider the semantic code that we use. Why don't we think, for example, about the complex language of the informal consent? And when you know you give to a patient an informal consent, you have an emotion and a cognitive component, and the same is for the patients. So I think that moral reasoning is a very nice example to understand this conflict between emotion and cognition. Now, at the very beginning, while defining the aspect of moral reasoning, for example, Kolber, who was the one, the first, let's say, trying to give a nice definition of moral reasoning, he only gave a lot of details concerning the cognitive correlates of moral reasoning. But it was clear in 1980, for example, that also the emotional component is extremely important in moral reasoning, as, for example, the origin of human morality is also classified by a set of emotions, such as, for example, the caring, the cooperation, the sympathy, and empathy. And you know very well, as physicians, that those processes are extremely important when you take care of patients, especially chronic patients. Now, of course, neuroscience tried to put into models decision making, which is because this one is one of the most complex behavior of humans. And one of the effort was, for example, to explain these, putting a frame of mathematical models, and in particular Bayesian models, basing on a probabilistic decision. For example, if you make a mathematical calculation, you can say that eating McDonald's, it's not good for healthy, okay? Anybody will agree with this, but my question is this a strictly human decision? I don't think you think so, because there is a lot of person who decide anyway to go for McDonald's, even probably in the audience. Now, the problem is that when we take risk, the rational decision is a myth, because human risk-taking is not only a mathematical calculation, like, for example, in genetics. It's a different thing. Decision-making models should involve also cognitive processes and emotional components, and provide the neurobiological correlates of these processes. So going further with the model of decision-making, you can see that, for example, in this model, there are different components. Learning by experiences, for example, and then compare what you are previewing about the decision, for example, a therapeutical trajectory, and what's going on, so making in a way predictions. And you can understand that a lot of cognitive components are part of these models, but also emotional components. And again, as you can see, looking further, these different cognitive and emotional components, there are also neuroimaging experiments demonstrating that different neural systems came up and have different roles in this. So, an important component is free will. Free will is the component making, for example, the rules of the informed consent. So free will is a relevant component of decision making. And this is very interesting. What neuroscience tell us that, for example, the brain seems to ramp up before movements. So before we decide to move, the brain, in a way, has already decided what to do. And there are a number of experiments. I can go into details, but I assure you that there is evidence of this, also measuring the readiness potential, which is something that starts in the brain before you decide to move. In any kind of experimental setting. Now, so this is what happens in normal subjects. But we are also discussing the topic of patient. Let's make the example, for example, of neurological or neurosurgical patients. Well, in this case, the different impairment of different areas into the brain makes this patient difficult the decision making. So we have to take care also of these. And we can put this into this kind of models. Now, is decision making regulated by this dichotomy between emotion and cognition? Well, we have recently demonstrated in normal subjects, for example, that the higher the body awareness, the lower the risk taking on the body. So there are vegetative indexes into our body, which are regulated by our brain, that make us making different decision making, which is not only cognition. Now, I would like to finish by saying why patients and doctors make irrational decisions concerning therapies. I'm going to give you a few examples in Italy, because of course I would like also to relate this to a cultural example, so it's easy for me. Now, let's start with the Bonifacio serum. The Bonifacio serum is based on the use of oncoclasina. Dr. Bonifacio proposed to use this compost by which is done by goat feces and urine, with a supposed efficacy on cancer, as goats never get cancer, which is not truth at the end. Well, there was a very big story, as you can see, also on the media concerning this. Well, I would like to move, but it's not moving anymore. I don't know why. I would like to go to the to the following. Okay. And then, after this, we had, before, well, the DiBella multi-therapy. I know that probably you know this story, promoted by Dr. DiBella, 1997, quite recently, is an alternative cancer therapy without any scientific evidence, any. If I say any, I say really any. In 1999, the Italian Health Ministry indeed decided anyway to start a formal trial on this, which is strange because there was no scientific evidence of any kind of efficacy, and I have to say that hundreds of patients died because the DiBella, okay? And then we end with the stamina case. The stamina case has been proposed as a therapy for neurodegenerative disease, which is something that is very close to me because I am a neurologist, without any, again, scientific evidence of efficacy. Invented by Davide Vannoni, supported, who is a psychologist, supported by the Stamina Foundation, which is an important foundation, which was an important foundation, and he was the president of this foundation. Davide Vannoni, at the end, was convicted of fraud. Okay, which is good, of course. Now, what are scientists thinking about this? I would like to make the name of Professor Veronesi, that probably you know, one of the several scientists against the DiBella, not only against the DiBella, the Bonifacio, and also the stamina method. He found many similarities between these cases, and the Bonifacio and the DiBella cases in particular. And he said that these experimentations were all promoted under the boosts of the public opinion rather than basing on scientific evidence. And I think that this is a very relevant thing, a very relevant component also looking at the decision-making models. And in particular, for example, Randy Shechtman, who is a Nobel Prize, he said that Vannoni was a criminal. So, of course, the position of scientists is very clear about this problem. Now, I would like to conclude by saying that decision making, and I really hope to have, in a way, persuade you that decision making involves both cognitive and emotional component, and we should take care of this because cognition and emotion are frequently in conflict. So the decision depends on different factors, the physical features of the options, in a way, the way we are proposing, for example, treatments to patients, the characteristics of the outcomes predicted by the options, the salience, the probability, which is the degree of certainty, and then the timing. It's very important also the timing. I'm finishing. The previous experience, which is important again, don't forget the memory problems of a number of patients, also in oncology. In other words, we need complex model to approach the problem of decision making when planning therapeutic strategies involving the neuropsychological and also the cultural and ethical component, which is something that also science, neuroscience, should learn. We need this kind of complex models. Thank you for your attention.